I mean, talk about endings. It really says something when I'm sitting here like, oh, hey, Peter Head, good to see you again. Don't get me wrong, he's terrifying, but I could hardly even stand him with the flesh lips. Thankfully, they're only in one encounter. You don't gotta deal with them for very long, but I fucking hate the bubble-headed nurses. Their weird, tumorous, clay-like faces, the way they walk. And see, one of them coming towards me is nothing but pure anxiety. Of all the entries on the list, Brookhaven is the one that I absolutely cannot stand, but in the way that makes them the most fitting number one. The atmosphere is masterful, the symbolism behind it is fascinating.
Thank you. purple flowers.
As the night
focused on dominance and devious power structures that push this nasty doppelganger above and beyond. It builds horror game tension better than most horror games. And it just needs one sound to keep us remembering the footsteps. Oh my god, the footsteps. And excuse me, how many? It will never be easy to wake up. Dreams unravel our minds into a personalized blur of visions too powerful for reality. But we don't always wield that power. Nightmares can effortlessly turn everyday rest into what feels like on and off death. As if something takes us, tortures us in the one place where we're always alone. Yeah, hi, Evanescence? You might want to sit out for this. Cover your eyes. Roll over. Good boy. Despite its success, it's the same throughout my lifespan. Obvious, the star scarier still collects respect. It was hard making just one animatronic for this job. But despite spring traps and endless volleys, nightmare is what snacks on my psyche. I can hardly even with this man in what feels like a push to Sisyphi every other dread. Five Nights of Horror, this deadly dream team transforms the realm beyond the pillar into something even the worst can't handle. Look at this! It's got all the red glow-in-the-dark eyes, fur that's been passed through 12 cemeteries, crude method claws, a jigsaw trap for a stomach, and just this cruel seething stare. Barring the looks, holy shit! The teethage is real. It's the presence in-game and ultimate meaning behind the blackest bear that qualifies it as the gatekeeper of top three. Its infernal attack pattern and abuse of FNAF 4's terrifying sound design sauces me up with feral anxiety and hopeless jitters before scarfing down my soul. But it's the finest details that carve nightmare into my skin. Think about what it does. A gruesome skeletal shadow that haunts a terminally wounded child and wayward sinner for his irredeemable acts of child experimentation and murder. It's a killer, a reminder of our great fear of death, the eternal sleep. I may never hold a teddy bear again.
Much scarier than fiction. Although fiction loves to raise those hairs all the same. their match. I'm not even kidding when I say the Guardians are the new scariest monsters in the Zelda universe, created by the suspiciously gifted Sheikah tribe to do war in the defense of Hyrule against the primordial Ganon. These autonomous terrors stand as a sinister symbol of world-shattering betrayal and apocalypse. What could turn a proud kingdom of light into dead, silent wilderness? A fleet full of giant laser-blasting robot octopus, of course.
What?
confirmed by the trilogy's end that the Plasm Wraith is indeed the cause of the shipwrecks. Red flag right out of the gate. You're telling me there's a gravity-mocking monster out to forsake my freedom? Am I just a fly in the spider's web? You know, I'm already freaked out. I'm dialing it back. Funny man, this already ominous enemy raises the nope even higher with mythological basis. You know what this thing's called in Japanese? Amibosu. Like Umibosu, the aqueous ghost of Japanese legend. Yeah, I'm a jealous fan. This icon of folklore is greatly feared for stories of it shipwrecking vessels at sea. And what does it want? To kill the captain. Stop! Stop being creepy! The status quo of its mythological drive dictates that the Plasm Wraith is essentially the main antagonist of the series, playing the part of Kraken, dragging us down to a horrible death.
That's the idea.
But the consistent nuances turn this into something even creepier. Its behavior in Pikmin 3 is straight up scary. Having finally caught Olimar, the Plasm Wraith doesn't actually kill him. It mothers him overprotectively, even consciously activating the forced sleep mode in his spacesuit to keep him from escaping and slowly killing him through exhaustion. That's dark. No, that's evil. I'm starting to feel sick just knowing that this freaky, wobbly devil silently looms over you through every game. It's haunting. And I'll tell you what, the transparent threads puppeted by the Plasm Wraith's unending influence effectively snares my imagination and drags it where no other enemy can. Is it an evolved form of the Gulix and Water Wraith? Like how water slowly forms into organic matter? Skin? Protoplasm? Has it been learning with each defeat? Or is it their mother, so desperate for primal maternity that it fosters their killer? How and why can it spawn the planet's wildlife and elements? Why is it here? How is it still alive? What will it turn into next? Stop! Give me back my brain! The Plasm Wraith is number one on my list because of how much it's changed how I feel when playing Pikmin. Its disturbing behavior, uncanny design, and mysterious air of dominance. Everything about it just feels so wrong. Even if it wasn't such blatant theory bait, I'd still stick to my guns. Fear is golden. This is being Fuffle's Minion. Fly safely. Thanks for watching, guys. Please consider supporting the not-so-great Fuffle's Minion on Patreon for just $1 a month. Link down in the description. A hearty hello and welcome back, everyone, to Rotary Mastery. Time to throw that brisk ace in the blender and stand off with the biggest, the baddest, and their very own list. Employment in the virtual realms hilariously lacks, where you can reap restitution feeding the bejesus at a big boss bin and get that bonus check. Everyone's doing it, and the poor reason has yet to rise. So many games and so many opinions came and passed since my original list. A single-player build-up to a battle with myself, and I'll still probably end up losing it. But who cares? A lot of fun filling the winning pot, and this guy can't get enough. Few quick notes as per usual. One per franchise, and no first bosses, final bosses, super bosses, or Kirby bosses. Why? No why. So what's the criteria? Well, honestly, I just kinda like them. Ready, set, to battle! The longer you stay within the virtual realm, the stronger you are. Your way is the finding a new answer to the question everybody already knows. Bosses are the best. Nothing from here how you conquer them. Dominant strategy, challenge, or solution. Make your way. My favorite. I can't to say I was split on my favorite Mega Man boss would be put in mild. As a series all about encouraging different boss strategies, Capcom's finest sure makes the most important decision as soft as a Reggie Rock boner. The obvious game for me is X4, but God, it hurt to pick. So both Split, Mushroom, and Magma Dragoons, Mono e Mono with Zero, share the glory. Why Zero? One very good reason. Z-Saber only, with no weapon weakness or ranged buster shots to get in their way. Only the savage art of chop 'em to bits can settle it. And oh my mecha god, are these two crazy? Scaly Akuma over here wears the fan favoritism proud with a tragic story-based rivalry with Zero, submitting to Sigma's anarchy solely to fight him to the death, assuring the inferno of adrenaline ignited by his explosive attacks and gratuitous cross-referencing would be met with disheartening in silence. Taking on Dracoon without the right armor is mad tense and wholly satisfying. But Split Mushroom without his weakness is a vortex of the fun in Fun Guy took some of Sonic's Happy Pills and rented out the Tetris board for 80 seconds of atomic pinball. Him and his soul body clone top around at insane speed and insane angles. Constant spinning, toxic gas clouds. Trying to avoid all this and hit the real target is crazy. You'll swear your controller's on fire by the time you're done. You've got to try this if you haven't.
Turn in my freak card. Was hoping the height of Pikmin
bosses would blow my expectations to Kingdom Come. I guess I can work with just, Quagmire Clops. I'm mad that I didn't come up with this. It's some piece of work. The kind of work you didn't even think was needed. But I can vouch for Pikmin 3. I definitely needed this. What in the demon-spooning glob of goat-milking Goliath even is this? A giant clod of wet dirt with moon and tree roots for legs. Rainbow slug for tongue. And prickly eyeballs. Strawberry for a brain? Yes, it's a game. Never mind that it's the biggest Pikmin creature yet. This tends to stupidly bizarre. So make that conceptual result at the head of the company. Brilliant. But what's a freak show without a sense of joy? Well, even though I might be the one talking about, it's pretty good. Firefox's choice of a reader invokes a lot of trouble, as mud means water, limiting the offensively challenged Pikmin in the Seamus office. Kick its shins together, but the heroes are gonna break that crystal protecting the brain. So you gotta break through it with rocks to reveal the weak. Fun fact that it can crush the crush-resistant Pikmin, drown four of the five types with the shifting mud, and lap its giant porn star tongue on loan from trans pride Licky Licky dangers, constantly eyeballing your juicy carrot sleeves. Bit of patience, though, and the hogwash concludes. Challenging, weird, memorable, awesome, awesome. Funny how games work sometimes. Say you touch a hot stove IRL. What do you do? Roar in pain, kiss it with a bazooka, then cry and hope you don't get a blister. Touch a hot stove in a video game? Do it again, it's worth points. Games often reward us for abusing bad tactics that miraculously work. And while it's fun, seeing the stove touch back? About time. No, I'd say this is cool, but I'd rather not have my palm frozen to my face. Better to have a smile on my face. And Arkham City's bestest of bosses got that as a day job. Mr. Freeze is one of those battles that continuously impresses. The tense path towards finding his cure has led Bats to an uneasy scuffle with Gotham's cryonic creep. I'd first like to praise the tone here. It's not petty hatred or the good versus evil status quo. Freeze only puts on his war face to emphasize how serious he is about getting his way back. Which he tasked the Caped Crusader to do. smart on their part. Made this out to be a test, and not just of Bruce's habits. You'd think the game that lets you back in would let you get away with everything. It does, except right here. Directly rambling Mr. Freeze to death is deemed too dangerous, so you're forced to use environmental set pieces to stealthily shove your bat boots up his chilly cheeks. So, yes, you actually gotta think like Batman for once. But referring back to the hot stove, love the irony there, Freeze is smart enough to ice the last spot you attacked from. You literally can't abuse the same strategies, forcing you to mix it up, play smart, and watch your positioning. That's awesome design. You truly feel like DC's best as you fight them. Stealth and subtlety galore. It's a Batfan's wettest dream. Shame they didn't get Schwarzenegger. All those stupid puns with this brilliant design would have been professionally retarded. It's no big deal, though. If you got it, flaunt it. While the most deceptive of the senses, a good sight is something anybody can not do. Making any given feast to the eyes do a bunch of flippy tricks and fancy schmoofs crank up the people's attention. Something the video game industry constantly abuses. But hey, spectacle takes work too. So I'll be a good little dollar sign and eat up. Mother of God. Oh wait, she dead. I've heard of go big or go home, but I'm pretty sure this thing ate my home. Big it is. Wish I already didn't make a Wumbo joke, because this is getting way too easy. As mixed as its flavor is, God of War demanded a mention here. Its bosses are mental, gigantic, super-powered lunks, aka gods, are the standard fare. And while not the most challenging or deep, Freeze's display of the Titan King Kronos is among one of the most jaw-dropping moments in any Sony exclusive. Just look. Look at him! Absolute Unit doesn't even come close to cutting it! This is stupid huge! Consider it cheating in a way. This isn't a boss, it's a level! Kratos, the unreal beast that he is, takes the scenic tour of this hygienically deprived continent with a face, slowly clawing his way up the arms, past the chest, and across the hands, decimating hilariously misplaced skeletons, popping his scabs, and tearing off his teeth! Eventually getting mega foobar when Kronos stupidly tries to bore Kratos. And, oh god, something bad's gonna happen. Jesus Christ, on Blu-ray and DVD! We got Kronos, splatter movie style, break out the temple clocks, stab him through the chin, and as he bleeds from his knife, pierce his freaking forehead, and finally he bows down dead. It's dumb, it's easy, but oh, man. You know the stock phrase, blink and you'll miss it? Yeah, irony's a dick like that. I get the fastest thing alive is good at making things dead the fastest, but no. Rings and dangerous speed. Sonic bosses have a bad quality. Easy, stupid, dumb. And they become stupid. You need to make sure you fight fast for the right reason. Ah, this might stick. Oh yeah, leave it to the big ass boo to get this free. Redeemed. King Boom Boom entertains on so many levels. Despite succeeding one of some features at least, Death Chamber gets me snoring, but the shady flea market stunt double of Luigi's arch nemesis, whatever his name was, got me woke. Crack those knuckles, this beatdown's gonna rock. Ever turn around and see a giant special ed marshmallow peep staring you down? Yeah, really love the tone they got going on. Constant goofy screaming from the spectral stupid meshes idiotically well with this atomic ass hauling towards the Duck the Angel Lasagna's green rock candy. He wants my penises! He's like a Kaizo furry bootleg of Pac-Man. It just cracks me up every time. But following hilarity and ectoplasmic fireballs is an intense table turn. Flip the hourglass, turn on the lights, sneak behind, and dig him up. Chase that booty down and end it! Oh, no, no, I didn't say you could go. Who's Sonic? I love this fight. Well, it does come and go real quick, like a lot of the Sonic bosses. This one actually left sizzling skid marks, hilarious tone, and blood-pumping pace. It's everything I want in a blue blur boss battle. I think I need one.
We'll be right back. Got it! Fire to the kitties.
Okay. Please, the love of God, do not say he's after me now. Yes. And done. That is all the DLC bosses now? Now, curiosity. Still there.
The knights of Aleone were there, so I pray.
Hey.
The knights of Aleone were there, so still remained. I pray.
It's probably a dumb idea, but. Oh, no, this is an insanely dumb idea. Interesting.